Hey everyone, today we will talk about how to design a job scheduler. So let's get started. Let's talk about functional requirements quickly. A user should be able to add, view, update, or delete a job and its schedule. User should be able to see the status of a job as well, whether a job is ready to run, whether it's running, failed, or completed. User should be able to see the execution history of a job as well. System should be able to retry the failed jobs. System should be able to trigger the jobs within 1 minute of schedule time. Job schedule frequency could be a combination of minute, hour, day, week, or a month as well. Recurring jobs may or may not have an end date attached to its schedule. Now let's talk about non-functional requirements. The system should be having a very low latency. Also, the system should be highly available. Now, before deep diving into designing the system, we should understand a job schedule may have a combination of minute, hour, day, week, or specific month as well. Okay. And the cron job format might look like this. Okay. And we need to take care of recurring jobs also accordingly. Also, the jobs which are supposed to run only one time as well. Okay. Now, let's talk about the design. Let's say there are users who are connected to user side API gateway and want to upload a job script and want to have a schedule attached to it. Okay. So, primarily, we need a service. Job manager plus job script uploader service. Okay. This service is responsible for uploading a job script in job script object store. And in order to maintain the schedule, okay, we need to have this information in the DB. We are keeping user ID, job ID, job frequency, and end date, if any, attached to it in the metadata DB. Okay, quite simple. Now, we need to understand how this database needs to be partitioned at a large scale. Okay, so basically, we are keeping user ID as a partition key here. And in order to sort the jobs also, we need to have this job ID as a sort key. And this job ID can be user ID underscore some timestamp attached to it. Okay, so job ID format could be user ID underscore epoch time. Okay, in order to make this sortable, we can also have the times of retry in case the jobs get failed. Also, the interval or the frequency, how frequently we want to run this job. Okay, now we also need a service which should be able to showcase the job execution history for all the jobs which user has scheduled so far. Okay, for which we need a job execution history service and a job execution status history DB, where we are also keeping the next runtime for these jobs, if any. Okay, now we also need to understand how we are going to partition this DB at a large scale. So here we are keeping job ID as the partition key. Okay. And execution ID, the last runtime for this job, as a sort key. Okay. And this execution ID could be a minute, label, epoch. Okay. And the status. And we can also maintain the worker ID internally to understand which worker was executing this job. Also, how many retry count has been exhausted so far. Okay, cool. Now we need job execution workers primarily to execute this job, and in order to execute job, the job execution workers also need to able to have access to job script object store. Okay, so that the idea is whenever the job gets triggered, these execution workers will primarily fetch one of the available jobs and fetch the appropriate JavaScript and start running it. Okay, so in order to do that, okay, the idea is job manager and JavaScript uploader service should be able to push the job created, updated, or deleted metadata to job scheduler service. Once the job schedule is updated by user and JavaScript is uploaded in the JavaScript object store. Once job scheduler service receives this information, job scheduler service needs to maintain the mapping of next runtime epoch level jobs, their frequency, and max retry. Okay, and the idea is every time the job is ready for the next run, okay, it keeps checking for next minute what are the applicable jobs needs to be run, and those jobs get triggered by job scheduler service, and these jobs trigger are consumed by job execution workers, which fetches the JavaScript from JavaScript object store, and metadata they have already received by job trigger message queue. Now they start working on it. Okay, now we also need to understand how we are going to partition job scheduler database. Okay, at a large scale we might want to have next execution epoch, basically a minute level epoch, as a partition key, and job ID could be a sort key here. Okay, now let's look at the entire flow. So once job scheduler service maintains the next runtime epoch level mapping of each job ID, so let's say a job is supposed to run for every day, okay, at some particular time, so this job scheduler service will have a next day epoch, particular minute epoch entry in the database, but it will not have the recurring mappings also being saved. Thus, recurring mappings will get only created once the job has completed his previous run. Okay, that's the idea. So for recurring jobs, we will only create the next runtime entry only when the previous entry and previous runtime entry is either completed or finished or it's being failed. Okay, so that's the idea. So job execution workers needs to update the status also. In order to do that, they'll start emitting the job status in the message queue, saying this particular job is whether it's running or failed or completed. Or for the first time job run, they will also emit a status saying, hey, the job is running. Okay, and for the first time a job run, job scheduler service will also emit an event saying, hey, this job is ready for the next run, in the same message queue. And whenever job execution workers emit completed status, this needs to be consumed by not just job execution history service but also the job scheduler service, okay, to have a next epoch entry updated for the job. Also, we are maintaining max retry count for failed jobs, so that whenever a job execution worker has an interrupted job, they can retry running the jobs again. Okay. Now, how to ensure the workers don't pick the same job? Okay, to do that, basically we need a worker manager, a worker assigner, so that it could maintain which workers needs to assign which job. Okay, so rather job execution workers consuming the new job from the job trigger message queue, worker assigner and retry service will primarily consume this data and assign a worker accordingly, and worker assigner only will be responsible for pushing all the status updates in the status update message queue. Cool. Now, what if some of the execution worker dies? Meanwhile, the job is being run. In order to handle the same, the idea is job execution workers needs to update their heartbeat with last epoch time, okay, when they were active, and probably what job ID they were working on and what was the job status in some local DB. And worker assigner service will not just only assign the workers to the job and retry the job, but will also look at the health check of the worker. So whenever a worker dies, this service will push the same job again to the job trigger message queue, and so that this job can be picked again within few minutes when this gets failed, and the same process can be continued. Okay, cool. So this is how we have designed this distributed job scheduler. All the job IDs are being also generated distributed fashion. They are supposed to be unique. That's why we have kept job ID as user ID underscore the last updated epoch time for that job. Okay, cool. Also, we can maintain some data in cache for the job execution history level. Primarily, people would be fetching or reading a lot more data to see whether their job's status has been updated or not. Okay, and this might be a huge read volume on the DB. So primarily, we can have status for the last few X jobs who were completed, failed, or the jobs which are having the next runtime already decided. Okay, this information we can keep in the cache for the active users so that they don't need to call DB again and again, and they can fetch the data from cache itself. And whenever a new information is available in the DB, we can also think of computing this and putting it into cache for active users. So whenever a non-inactive user comes into the system, the first call will be from the DB side, but from the all subsequent calls perspective, these calls will be served from the cache. Okay, cool. So this is how we have designed this system so far. Hope you like the video. Please like, share, and subscribe. Thank you.